Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. pledges stronger cooperation with Japan. He discussed this in Malacañang at a Friday meeting with the Secretary General of Japan's Liberal Democratic Party. The Japanese official noted the importance of the Philippines as Japan's neighbor and strategic partner.
I'm happy that we have come to a time where the relations between the Philippines and Japan are stronger than they have been in our entire history. Nonetheless, there is very still much to work on and to continue. And we look forward to the continuing support of the legislation and the political leadership of Japan. All that we have started to do.
The first ever joint exercise between Filipino and Japanese troops in the West Philippine Sea. The Philippine guided missile frigate BRP Jose Rizal joined a Japanese destroyer in communications and tactical maneuvering exercises. The maritime cooperative activity was held after both countries signed the deal for the deployment of their troops on each other's territories. A magnitude 6.8 quake strikes the coast of the Philippine province of Surigao del Sur. State seismologists said the epicenter of the quake was recorded off the coast of the town of Lingig. No damage was expected from the tremor, but authorities warned of possible aftershocks. A local disaster official said there were also no reported injuries. The tectonic earthquake was felt in the neighboring provinces of Davao de Oro and Agusan del Sur. Days after saying the government will not block any Interpol action with regards to the International Criminal Court's drug war probe, the Philippine Justice Department now says both the ICC and the Interpol are not allowed to arrest anyone here in the country. The DOJ clarifies they will not stop ICC officials from entering the country since they have the freedom to travel. But once they performed illegal acts, such as arresting people or serving a subpoena, they will be met with penalties.
Ang Interpol naman ay, yan ay membro ang Pilipinas. Yan ay meron tayong obligasyon na makipag-cooperate in police investigation and enforcement. Let me just state no na yung Interpol ay wala ring karapatan na mag-aresto sa atin. Gaya ng sabi ko nga kanina, ang ating gobyerno lamang ang merong poder para mang-aresto at gumawa ng mga lahat ng bagay na coercive powers. Wala hong anumang notisya na ginawa ng Interpol. Ang meron lang ay request ng ICC itself. Pinadaan sa DFA. Sa Department of Justice naman, dahil nga sa kadahilan ng hindi na tayo saklaw, we are no longer bound under the treaty, the Rome Statute. Therefore, yung request ng ICC itself through the DFA, it would just be, I guess, noted or no action.
The Philippine Finance Chief Ralph Recto says he's ready to answer questions on the legality of the transfer of PhilHealth's unused funds to the National Treasury. His comments followed the filing on Friday of a petition by groups before the High Court challenging the transfer of nearly 90 billion pesos in idle PhilHealth funds back to state coffers. Recto asserts the move follows the order of Congress that unused funds should be transferred back to the government. He adds measures taken by the government to fund its projects are consistent with its belief that the public's needs, including health, should not be compromised. The Marcos administration is poised to borrow more as it seeks a higher national budget for next year. A budget official on Friday said government could borrow around 1.5 trillion pesos in 2025, a slight increase from 1.4 trillion this year. Despite this plan, the DBM still expects the country's fiscal deficit to fall next year. The agency says the indicator of a government's ability to settle its obligations may go down to 5.3% from 5.6% in 2024. It attributed this to the country's economic growth and revenue collection.
It is more appropriate to compare borrowing against the capacity to borrow or the capacity of the economy to borrow. So we have a metric a fiscal target, a fiscal plan, which we call, of course, deficit to GDP ratio.
Yeah.
So the deficit to GDP ratio is now expected to go down in 2025 from 2024. So given the growth of the economy and the capacity of the economy to fund itself or for the government to be able to collect revenue, this represents a sort of a fiscal consolidation plan, wherein, of course, we have seen that this ratio, deficit to GDP, rose above 6.2 or even probably close to 6.4% during the pandemic.
The Philippine government hikes its wages and benefits for state personnel. President Marcos signed Friday Executive Order 64, which updates the salary schedule of civilian employees across the three branches of government. This also applies to personnel in constitutional commissions and offices. The Malacañang Presidential Palace says the move is meant to help state workers cope with prevailing economic conditions, such as elevated inflation. The executive order takes effect retroactively. Under this, qualified personnel also get a medical allowance worth 7,000 pesos per annum as a subsidy. A class action lawsuit is eyed by the Philippines over the oil spill from a tanker that sank in the waters of Bataan Province. Dennis Datu reports.
The Oil Spill Interagency Committee, led by the Department of Justice, is preparing to file a case against the owner of motor tanker Terra Nova. Days after it sank off the waters of Limay, Bataan, the vessel's leaking fuel oil has reached the shores of Cavite. In addition to criminal liability, the committee will also focus on compensation for those affected by the oil spill.
Ang usapan namin, we're looking into the angle of a class suit already, filed by the fishermen against the owners and others, no, who may be responsible for this.
Yung pagkakaso, tingin ko, kailangan kasuhan talaga para makita natin may negligence. Is this an act of God? Is there negligence on this? No, kasi this is a great, not only a health hazard for everyone, ecological damage ito. You're talking of 1.1 million of oils, no? Nangyari na po ito sa Mindoro, talagang ilang taon bago makabango ng ating kababayan.
The oil spill has affected the livelihood of more than 30,000 fishermen and vendors in Bataan.
Napakahirap dahil una-una hindi kami makatulog, lalo na yung mga kababayan natin na nangingisda. Dahil anytime pwedeng mag-leak, anytime pwedeng magkaroon ng problema na maapektuhan yung kanilang hanap buhay. Medyo mabigat na, kaya nanawagan kami sa PCG.
Meanwhile, oil levels of 7 milligrams per liter were found in the Navotas, while 3 milligrams per liter were detected in southern Metro Manila up to Cavite. The DNR standard for water to be considered clean is only 2 milligrams per liter. The VFAR has ordered a halt to fish harvesting in the part of Manila Bay where an oil spill has been detected to avoid food poisoning while awaiting the results of an analysis. Meanwhile, with the permission of the owner of the sunken tanker, ABS-CBN News reached ground zero or where the motor tanker Terra Nova sank. On the working barge of Harbor Star, the Salvor Company contracted to retrieve oil and float the oil tanker. Intensive training is being conducted for 14 technical divers. Their band masks are equipped with a camera and microphone so that what they see can also be seen in the control room. The divers can also communicate with the control room. Every day, diving for 25 minutes to familiarize themselves with the appearance of the oil tanker. This part of the preparation is necessary when the siphoning operation begins. According to Harbor Star, no oil was observed leaking from the oil tanker for 3 days now, but a thin layer of oil is noticeable in the surrounding area. Oil spill booms have been laid out to contain the spread of the oil sheen. According to Harbor Star, the position of motor tanker Terra Nova is tilted at a 45-degree angle on its port side. But in the inspection conducted, no cracks were found in any of its 4 cargo tanks, even though it has been submerged in the seawater for a week.
So far, tatagal pa naman siya kasi yung last survey namin kanina, yung integrity ano namin na chinecheck, wala pa nang failure, wala pang sign of failure.
Intact pa rin.
Representatives from the U.S. Coast Guard and the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration are scheduled to arrive to assist in the oil spill response. 2 technical experts from Germany, hired by Harbor Star, are also expected to arrive.
Motor tanker Terra Nova is not the only problem for Bataan. There's also motor tanker Jason Bradley, which sunk near Maribeles and is continuing to leak over 5,000 liters of diesel. 5 villages in Maribeles are affected.
Meron ng mga huli na hindi lang visually may para may langis at may amoy, kundi kapag niluto, talaga malalasahan mo yung langis. Ang assumption is galing sa Bradley dahil mas amoy daw yung diesel.
The Salvor Company has arrived to suck around 5,500 liters of diesel from motor tanker Jason Bradley. The oil extraction will last for 7 days.
May mga divers na rin po ngayon na nagdadive galing po dito sa Salvor na ito. So patuloy po yung pag-assess kung saan po ilalagay yung mga pipes para po makapagsimula na po tayo ng siphoning dito sa motor tanker Bradley.
Dennis Datu, ABS-CBN News.
A second straight oil price rollback looms in the coming week. Estimates show diesel and kerosene prices may fall by 40 centavos per liter, while gasoline may be cheaper by as much as 30 centavos. The Energy Department says the plan of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, or OPEC, to boost global supply may keep prices low. But Middle East tensions and decreasing oil inventory in the U.S. may push prices up or make rollbacks smaller. A measure seeking to protect so-called defensive drivers from detention when they figure in an accident caused by reckless drivers is filed at the Philippine House of Representatives. Vivian Gulia tells us more.
The truck Narciso drove suffered a minor dent after it was hit by the truck behind him during heavy traffic along Commonwealth Avenue Friday morning.
Nagulat talaga ako, bigla lang kumalabog yung likod namin, yun lang. Tapos pagtingin ko yan, nabangga na kami pala. Di ko alam doon sa bumangga sa amin kung anong rason nila, ba't bumangga sila sa amin. Sana mag-ingat na rin sila sa ano.
Ha?
Mag-ingat na rin sila kasi tulad natin, sobrang ingat natin sa ano. Yung sa likod pala natin o sa mga gilid natin, di masyado nag-iingat.
Oo.
Buti nga na, walang nadamay na tao.
While the truck behind Narciso's had a bigger damage, its driver admitted his brakes failed. Narciso is among the drivers who figured in a traffic accident despite exerting effort to be careful and responsible on the road. The same thing is true for the driver of the vehicle that got hit by a counterflowing and speeding motorcycle along Skyway Stage 3 last March. The rider died, which prompted the detention of the vehicle driver until the Quezon City Prosecutor's Office dismissed the complaint against him. This is one of the incidents cited by two congressmen who filed a measure seeking to protect defensive and responsible drivers from detention when they figure in an accident caused by so-called kamote or reckless drivers. House Bill 10679, authored by Representatives Margarita Nograles and Gino Almario, prohibits the detention of motor vehicle drivers who can provide sufficient proof of defensive driving in a traffic accident. Among the proofs mentioned in the bill, which drivers can present, are dash cam or other videos, CCTV footage, or photos showing that they did not violate any traffic law before and during the incident.
Sobrang unfair din, no? Na tayo, nag-iingat tayo, and yet people out there, parang baliwala lang sa kanila yung safety nila, tsaka ng ibang tao. Whoever was injured in the accident gets, you know, the rights na. Pero if you look at it na naman, if it is something inflicted due to irresponsible driving, it doesn't make sense naman din. You are rewarding an irresponsible act.
The measure, however, does not prohibit the arresting officer from acquiring and processing the personal information and impounding the vehicle of the driver involved in the accident. It also states that the driver shall not be exonerated from liability in the traffic incident based solely on the evidence provided in the bill, which means that he can still be the subject of a complaint.
We're not trying to change the whole justice system in a big way then in terms of this kind of case, no? Pero at least to provide an avenue where drivers can rely on to be able to prove their innocence.
One rider, Party List Representative Ramon Rodrigo Gutierrez, agrees with the direction of the bill, but notes of a concern.
Although obvious naman sa atin sa camera, hindi po natin masasabi until may ruling po talaga either yung PI, yung preliminary investigation ng prosecutor, or yung through a court ruling po, no? So doon lang po kami nagkakaroon ng disagreement. Whether it will be amending the criminal code or we will seek out the help from the Supreme Court.
Gutierrez and the authors of the bill are open to threshing out the issues and refining the measure once it is tackled in the House committee. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
President Marcos touts the role of journalists in combating disinformation in unregulated social media. He gave the remarks during the Friday oath-taking of the Board of Trustees of the Association of Philippine Journalists Samahang Plaridel Foundation. The president himself has been the victim of a deepfake video in which he supposedly ordered Philippine troops to attack China. Marcos says his administration recognizes the role of a free press in ensuring a vibrant and functioning democracy. He also assured journalists of his administration's support in ensuring their safety and well-being.
In this time of unregulated social media, of fake news, artificial intelligence, now more than ever, we need your help in empowering our people to distinguish the truth from fiction and facts from blatant lies. For one, you help keep our people informed of important news and current events, ensuring that there is a healthy and enlightened, meaningful discourse on matters of public importance.
The Commission on Elections holds a time and motion simulation for the use of the new automated counting machines for the midterm polls. Our correspondent Katrina Domingo joins us on the line for more. Hi, Kat. Good afternoon.
Hi, Rika. Basically, what the Commission on Elections did today was to measure what is the most effective time for voters to review the votes that they cast on their respective ballots. What the Commission on Elections did today was that they set up four classrooms with 50 mock voters each. In the first classroom, voters will be given 20 seconds to review their votes after they fed the ballot into the automated counting machine. In the second room, they will be given 15 seconds to review their votes, while in the third room, they will not be allowed to review their votes at all. In the fourth room, on the other hand, they will be given all the time that they need to review the votes that they cast on their ballot after feeding it again into the automated counting machine. COMELEC Chairman George Garcia tells us that the COMELEC will gather the data after the entire activity and then decide which is the most efficient time limit for voters to review their ballot. The COMELEC says this is an important exercise so that the policies and guidelines that they will implement on voting day next year would actually be based on data and not just on the whim of any official. The COMELEC chairman tells us that they expect the review to happen by next week and that they will make sure that voters, especially senior citizens, will be given all the time that they need to cast their votes next year. Aside from this, Rika, COMELEC chairman George Garcia also tells us that he intends to coordinate with the United States Department of Justice to flag a possible bank fraud case after a U.S.-based bank account was allegedly used to pose as his offshore account. If we recall, Sige Party List Representative Rodante Marcoleta earlier claimed that the COMELEC chairman owned illegal offshore accounts in New York and in Cayman Islands, both of which Garcia had dismissed as fake. Garcia says that it will be up to the United States DOJ to investigate on the matter, especially that the U.S. has enacted or has enforced its Patriot Act, which mandates American agencies to strictly enforce policies to prevent fraud. Rika.
Hi, Kat. Just one question. They just did the time and motion simulation. Nothing on the simulation of how fast the voter returns will be uploaded?
None of that sort so far yet. The only thing that they measured earlier was how quick the machines would actually be able to process each ballot and how much time voters would actually need to review their votes.
Mm-hmm. Lisa? What about the number of voters that they used on the simulation and how the vote counting machines will act or will work on the whole day basis of the election, like on one whole day of an election?
Because so far they just used 200 voters, that means 50 mock voters for each of the four rooms that they set up earlier. It will not necessarily show us how many or how fast the machine could actually perform in an entire day. Mm-hmm. But basically the goal of today's exercise was to just measure how much time each voter needs for them to review the votes that they cast. This particularly is a new feature under the automated counting machine, a feature that was not available in the old Smartmatic machines because the previous system that we used did not actually have a large screen monitor where voters will actually be allowed to check on the names that they shaded on the ballot.
Mm-hmm. Rica. All right. Thank you so much, Katrina Domingo, reporting live. Now, beginning this school year, another track will be added to the country's senior high school curriculum aimed at equipping students to be entrepreneurs and digital leaders. Joyce Balancho has more.
Online selling. This is how senior high school student Kaymar Fega helps her parents earn additional income. She says it was one of the ways her family survived the peak of the COVID-19 pandemic.
Yung online platform is a good platform para makapag-promote ng gusto natin i-promote. Or katulad nun, sa business side, nakakatulong siya kasi nga, nakahelp din siya sa family namin.
The Department of Education, or DepEd, is adding a new specialization in senior high school to help students like Kay, who are eyeing to pursue a career in online business. On Thursday, DepEd signed a memorandum of agreement with the Department of Trade and Industry and the Thames International School to integrate e-commerce into the curriculum beginning this school year 2024 to 2025. The program aims to help senior high school graduates get readily available and in-demand jobs. The program also includes work immersion in e-commerce companies.
Isa sa mga pangunahing utos ng ating mahal na Pangulo na bigyan natin ng trabaho, bigyan natin ng pag-asa ang ating mga kabataan. At bago natin sila mabibigyan ng trabaho, kailangan natin bigyan sila ng karanasan. Kailangan natin bigyan sila ng kaalaman. At that is the job of the DepEd.
The Thames International School will pilot the program in 50 schools in the National Capital Region, Central Luzon, and Calabarzon, where many e-commerce businesses are located. In the succeeding years, THEMS will train the other DepEd schools to expand the program and cover more areas.
Yung training, yung curriculum na has been approved by DepEd, focuses on ano ba yung kailangan ng mga e-commerce companies, di ba? Digital marketers, di ba? They need supply chain and logistics specialists. Kailangan lang ng mga data analytics, sabi nga ni Sec. People will be able to do online security and computer systems.
DepEd also targets to enhance the training of students on information technology, particularly animation and games and software development. The department signed a memorandum of agreement with the Philippine Board of Investments for its implementation.
Marami pong mapasok dyan na makabagong mga industriya, yung artificial intelligence, software development, game development, animation, yung hindi pangkaraniwan ba, hindi pa bahagi ng ating curriculum. Pero ngayon pa lang, nakikita natin may potential.
Philippine Business for Education, or PBED, lauds the inclusion of these trainings into senior high school education, saying this will address the job skills mismatch among Filipino graduates. On Friday, DepEd also sealed its partnership with Khan Academy Philippines for the use of innovative technologies to aid in the students' mastery of math and other subjects. Khan Academy is a nonprofit educational organization that specializes in making practical exercises, instructional videos, and personalized learning dashboards that enable learners to study at their own pace.
This rationale for Khan Academy Philippines, and really for any ed tech tool, is to strengthen basic ed. And that means our foundational skills in math, science, reading, critical thinking, and to do well on a test like PISA.
Due to limited resources of some schools, DepEd says it will come up with a strategic plan on how to implement the program.
Rather than operate on the assumption of one student, one computer, maybe just work with one classroom muna, one teacher, start there, and then improve your ratios as you go along, no? Parang doon tayo pero importante, we have a good spread across the country dun sa makikinabang dito.
Khan Academy Philippines targets to reach 1 million Filipino students by 2026. Joyce Balancho, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Foreign Affairs Department raises the lowest alert level in Bangladesh amid civil unrest in the country. The agency on Friday warned that the security situation in the South Asian country can deteriorate without warning. It also urged Filipinos in Bangladesh to exercise precaution and restrict non-essential movement. Those in need of assistance were told to contact the Philippine Embassy in Dhaka. Student-led protests broke out in Bangladesh last month over quotas in government jobs. This escalated into deadly clashes that has left over 200 people dead. The Philippines asks Yemen to help secure the release of 17 Filipino sailors held captive by Houthi rebels since November. They make up the crew of the MV Galaxy Leader, which the Houthis seized in the Red Sea and brought to the Yemeni part of Hodeidah. The honorary Philippine consul to Yemen appealed for the release on humanitarian grounds. Some of the crewmen are reportedly stricken with malaria. The Philippine Foreign Office says the Yemeni government has sent medical aid and doctors to the hostages.